the surface tension. Okay, so we will discuss surface tension for some time and then we'll take a break. Okay, write down surface tension. Okay, have you ever seen insect walking on the surface of the water? Yes. Is it because the buoyant force? Is it because the buoyant force, buoyancy, is the legs of the insect inside the water or on the surface only? It is on the surface, on the surface. Okay, so it has nothing to do with the buoyant force. The gravitational force of the insect is balanced by some other force. It is not even viscous force. For viscosity, viscous force, you need to have velocity or movement inside the liquid. Movement inside the liquid is required, then only viscous force is there. So it is neither viscosity that balances gravity nor the viscosity nor the buoyant force. Fine, it is something else, and it has to be based on the surface because the leg of the insect doesn't go inside the surface. Okay, so we are going to discuss about a surface property of the fluid. All right. So what happens is that every fluid surface behave like a stretched membrane. It's like when you blow air inside the balloon surface, exactly like that. Okay. This is how every fluid surface behaves like. Okay. So what is so special about the surface? And this property of every fluid surface is different. Like for example, the surface of water will have a different type of surface tension. The surface of the, honey surface will be different type. So every surface of the fluid is different types. Okay, so what is so special about it? Let us see that first. So let's say you have a beaker which has fluid inside. It has a fluid. Okay, now we know that the in case of solid, let's go down to the basics. In case of solid, the atoms are close, very close. They form a lattice kind of thing. Okay, in case of solid, in case of liquid, the atoms and molecules are slightly away. And in case of gas, ideal gas, atoms don't interact. They're very, very far away from each other. One atom has nothing to do with what the other atom does. Okay. So in case of solid, the van der Waals force between the molecules of the atoms is very large. Very, very large. So they are very close to each other. In case of liquid, again, there is a van der Waals force between the molecules or the atoms. That is why they are close to each other, but not as strong as it was in case of solids. In case of gas, the van der Waals force is absent. Okay. Now, the molecule, let's say take example of water. Okay. So not only van der Waals force, but hydrogen bonding is also there. Okay, so take for example a molecule on the surface over here. and a molecule inside. A molecule inside feels the attraction at different directions. In fact, multiple directions it get attracted. Okay? And the point on the surface will experience the force only in half of the directions. Getting it? Now my question to you is, which molecule is more stable? Molecule one, which is inside, or molecule two, which is outside? Which one is more stable? When attraction is more, then it is more stable, or when the repulsion is more, then it is more stable? Okay, if you are a little confused, I'll give you a scenario. Okay, all of you look at this scenario. It's like this, guys. If you have, let's say, one spring only, one mass like that, or you have spring on both sides, okay, which one do you think more stable? If I displace it this side and this also that side, which mass, which scenario the mass will make more effort to go back? More effort to go back. This one, right? So more, this is more stable. This one, it tries to retain its position more. Okay. So same thing over here also. Okay. So basically more attraction. You see, the thing is that I can't get down to the atomic level discussion with you. I have to take the analogy to make you explain why it is more stable, right? Otherwise, I'll just have to tell you that assume it is more stable. Fine. So more attraction means, more attraction implies more stability. More stability means higher energy or lesser energy? More stability means higher potential energy or lesser potential energy? All of you? More stability, lesser potential energy. Lesser potential energy. Okay. So what is a natural tendency of any substance in the universe? To have as less potential energy as possible. This is a natural tendency, right? That is a natural tendency. So basically liquid, I'll write one more thing here. Lesser potential energy. So the molecules at the surface have higher potential energy, right? Molecules at the surface has higher potential energy. Okay. So the natural tendency of every substance in the universe is to decrease its energy. Fine. So basically, the liquid, every liquid will try to decrease its energy by having lesser number of molecules at the surface. How can it be done? Lesser number of molecules at the surface. How will you achieve it? How it is actually done? how it is done? How will you have lesser molecules on the surface? How can we have lesser molecules on the surface? Yes, Hariharan got it. Advik got it. Correct. Correct. Lose out by evaporation. No, surface area will not change. Okay. So basically having lesser surface area. Okay, if the surface area is less, the number of molecules on the surface will be automatically less. Okay, so the natural tendency of any liquid is what? Liquid will try to reduce its surface area. Okay, this is what liquid will try to do. Fine. Now, for a given volume, do you know which geometry has least surface area? If volume is fixed, least surface area is what? Do you all know sphere? Right? It is a sphere. Okay. So, for a given volume, a sphere has least surface area. Fine. So if you do not have gravity, if you don't have gravity, the liquid will try to take a shape of a sphere. Okay, that is the reason why if in a space, if let's say water body is there, it will try to create a sphere, a spherical shape. Okay. So shape of the fluid body will be spherical due to surface tension. Okay. All right. So we'll take a break, guys, right now. We'll continue after the break, right? So we all will meet at 6:15 now. All of you take this break and come back in time. All right. All right, so let us continue. So we have discussed about the surface tension philosophically. The idea of surface tension we have discussed. We haven't yet discussed mathematically what it is. How will you put a number that this is the surface tension? Or how can you say surface tension is 5 or 10, right? So now we'll talk about how to put a number, okay? What should I define surface tension as to be equal to? Fine. So write down. Surface tension is defined as surface energy per unit area. I'll just tell you how does it makes sense. You'll claim that no, let us define surface energy as surface tension, not surface energy per unit area. The problem with defining surface energy as surface tension is that if you take same liquid, lesser area and more area. The energy of substance which has more surface area will be more automatically, because number of molecules are more at the surface. Okay, so the property doesn't become only of the liquid. It is not that a same liquid will have same surface tension then. Same liquid, depending on the surface area, will have different surface tension, because you have defined surface tension as total surface energy. Okay, but if you define surface tension as energy per unit area, then it doesn't matter how much area of the surface you take. Density of the energy or surface energy per unit area will remain same. It becomes independent of the amount of area you take on the surface. Then that surface energy per unit area depends only on which liquid you are talking about. Not only that, actually, it depends on between which two mediums the interface is. Suppose interface is between water and air, okay? There will be one surface tension between water and air. There will be another surface tension between water and solid, okay? So basically, this surface energy, or sorry, I mean here surface tension. Surface tension is defined as, so surface tension is a surface property. Okay, and surface belongs to both the mediums. It doesn't belong to only one medium because it is an interface. Okay, it belongs to two mediums. Okay, and that's the reason why surface tension only depend upon which two mediums the surface or the interface is. Getting it? It only depends on that, and of course it depends on temperature also, which we sometimes ignore, but it is good to remember that if temperature increases, both, you know, viscosity as well as surface tension, they both go down. Okay, fine. Surface tension is surface energy per unit area. Its representation is S. Okay, so it will be joule per meter square. That is a unit for the surface tension. Getting it? So if you multiply surface tension with surface area, what do you get? If you multiply surface tension with surface area, you'll get what? Everyone? Correct. Total energy of the surface due to surface tension. Okay, very simple. Fine. Energy you get, energy. Anyone has any doubts till now? Please type in yes or no. Why I'm spending more time over here? Because I know this topic is ignored. That's why I'm spending more time over here. Anyone has any doubt? Quickly type in yes or no. Akash, Nishant, no doubts. Okay, fine. Now there is another way of defining surface tension. There is another way of defining surface tension. We have learned the way with respect to energy, because that makes more sense the way we have discussed about the surface tension. Okay, we also know that work done is basically change in potential energy, right? You remember that work done is the negative of change in potential energy, right? What is the work done? FdR, this is equal to negative of change in potential energy, right? So force is du by dr, all right? So wherever there is potential energy, there will be force also, okay? So you can define the potential, you can define the surface tension with respect to force as well, okay? So write down, surface tension can also be visualized as, surface tension is also visualized as force per unit length. Okay, force per unit length is also surface tension. Okay, getting it? The direction of the force, direction of the force is always perpendicular to the line, to actually to any imaginary line, to any line you can imagine. I mean, it is a very weird way of telling, but then this is true. If there is on the surface, if you draw a line like this, this line will experience a force both sides like this, because it is like a stretched membrane. There is a force in both directions like that. You can draw any line, the force will be perpendicular to it. Getting it? All of you? See, this definition is little bit more, let's say, counterintuitive. You'll have to solve few questions to appreciate this. Okay, so let's discuss this. All of you, we'll conduct just a small, you can say, a small demonstration. Of surface tension S being force per unit length. Okay, all of you pay attention here. Imagine you have this rail. Okay, this is a, you can say, made out of thin wires. You have this U-shaped thing, and you have a movable, this blue stick can move sideways like that. Okay, in between over here, you have a soap film. There's a film over here. Do you understand the scenario? This is a film. You just dip it in this soap and water solution. You just take it out. There will be a film in between. Okay. Now, what is seen is that if I apply force like this, if I apply force, a very small amount of force, which displaces it a bit. Okay. Let's say this slides by a distance of D. Okay. And this length is L. This length is L. Okay. If surface tension is S. Now I'm going to ask you simple questions here. Okay. First of all, tell me, if I'm stretching it and the film remains intact, is surface area of the film increasing? Surface area of the film increasing or not? Quickly type in. No. Okay. Sir, when I'm stretching it, surface area of the film increases or not? Everyone. It increases, right? Will it? Why you said no? What is the reason? Someone said no. It increases, right? The area increases. So the surface area increases. Okay. Now, when surface area increases, the energy of the surface increases or not? Type in, does the energy of the surface increases when I stretch it? It increases. Simple, right? So energy has increased. From where that energy is coming from? How that energy is coming? Energy can't be created, right? Neither it can be destroyed. So from where this extra energy is coming? What do you think? Work done by the force. Do you all understand? The work done by the force increases the potential energy. You can write like this. This is the work energy theorem. Right? This is the work energy theorem. W is equal to U2 minus U1 plus K2 minus K1. Kinetic energy is almost zero. I am moving very, very slowly. So whatever work I do will be equal to the change in potential energy. Fine. So my force is equal to whatever force the film applies on me, so that the blue rod moves very, very slowly. Okay. So the work done is F into D, right? Force F into displacement D. So what is the change in potential energy in terms of surface tension? Can you write down that quickly? What is the change in potential energy? Okay, Madhav got something. Others? Aditya got something. Quickly type in, guys, whatever you think. All right, Hari Haran. See, surface tension is surface energy per unit area. So, if I multiply surface tension with change in area, I'll get increase in the potential energy. Right? So is this correct? SLD. Is this correct? Something is wrong. What is it? What it is? What's wrong here? Surface tension remains same. For surface tension, it doesn't matter whether the film is thin or thick, because entire film won't contribute to the surface energy. Only the molecules at the top will contribute. At the top, whatever number of molecules are there. Right? So it doesn't matter. But here you have two interfaces, yes or no? One at the top, one at the bottom. Everybody understand that? So two times. All of you understand this? One at the top of the film, one at the below the film. There are one set of molecules at top of the film. So liquid and air interface, one set of molecules at the bottom of the film, they will also be at the surface only, right? All of you understand? So this D and D get cancelled away, fine. So surface tension is F by 2L. Okay, just that, you know, here they have two interfaces. That is why a factor of two is coming in. Else, if only one interface, if only one interface, surface tension would have been simply force per unit length, right? So that is the reason why you can see length is perpendicular, sorry, the force is perpendicular to the length. You can see that my length is this blue line. Okay, so surface tension can be visualized in terms of force also. Force per unit length is also surface tension. Okay, and it is good, you know, it is good that surface tension can be visualized in terms of force as well as in terms of energy. You can solve every question of surface tension by either of these two methods. Okay, anyways. Now, whenever we talk about the surface tension, a discussion on the bubble and the drops becomes very important, because the reason why bubble and the drop take spherical shape is because of the surface tension. Okay, so write down drops and bubbles. So can you tell me what is the difference between drop and a bubble? First tell me that. Drop and a bubble, you have heard it enough, right? Drop and a bubble, what is the technical difference? Completely filled with liquid is drop and bubble is only thin film. Okay, bubble has more molecule, less molecule, air inside, bubble has air. Okay, position of air and water. Okay, tell me one thing. If the air is trapped inside the liquid, inside the water air is trapped, is that a drop or a bubble? Air is trapped inside a liquid, is a drop or a bubble? Bubble, all of you. So in our head, we have imagined that if it is a drop, it has to be liquid. Are you getting it? In our head, we have assumed that if it is a drop, it has to be liquid. It cannot be gas. Okay? That is what we have assumed. And that is not true. It is a drop of air. But loosely we say a bubble is inside the liquid. A bubble of air is trapped. But that's not true. It is a drop. Okay? So first and foremost, we need to understand what is the difference between drop and a bubble. Okay? So technical difference is very straightforward. Drop has one interface. Drop has one interface. Whereas a bubble has two interfaces. Bubble has two interfaces. So let me draw a drop and a bubble over here, then I'll tell you this is a drop, and let's say I create a bubble over here, this is a bubble, let's say both are spherical, of course. So this is liquid, this is air, one interface only, one interface. Okay, over here this is air, blue is liquid, and this is air. So here there are two interfaces, right? Air liquid and then liquid air. In case of a drop, you have only one interface. So this is drop and this is bubble. So now can you tell me if the air is trapped inside the liquid, how many interfaces are there? Air inside the liquid. only one. Okay, so technically it is a drop. Technically it is a drop, but loosely we say that it is a bubble, because in our head we already assume that, you know, the bubble should have air inside. Based on our day-to-day life experiences. Second. Okay. Fine. So, you know, the thing is that there is some relation between the pressure inside the bubble, surface tension, and the size of the bubble. So let us try to find out that. Okay. So the heading is, write down, relation between pressure and surface tension. Ajay, like, have you guys played with that thing wherein you blow air from your mouth and bubbles will come out? Have you played with that? It looks something like this. You blow air from it and the bubbles will come out. Have you played with that? Have you seen that? Yes. Okay. Tell me the size of this thing, bubble, will be more or less if you blow very fast. If you blow very, very fast, the size of the bubble will increase or decrease? Size of the bubble will decrease. It will be lesser. Okay, try that. Those who are saying that it will increase, please try this. And if you have to blow out a big bubble out of it, then you blow the air very, very slowly. So it expands slowly and slowly, it takes a big shape and then come out. Okay, nothing, Madhav, don't worry. It's not related to a cats. Okay, so basically this is what we are trying to find out, as in what is the relation between pressure and the surface tension. When we blow air very fast, the pressure inside the bubble is higher, or when we blow air very slowly, then pressure inside the bubble is higher. When it will be? When we blow the air very fast, then the pressure inside the bubble will be higher. Okay. So in a way, now based on your experience, you get a sense that if pressure inside the bubble has to be more, the radius has to be less. Size should be less. If pressure inside the bubble is lesser, the size of the bubble should be more. Bigger bubble should be there. Okay, so this is what we are trying to find out. Okay, so first we will do for the drop. Write down, case number one is for the drop. Very simple derivation, all of this. If you pay attention, it is very, very simple. Okay, take a drop of radius r. Okay, and then this drop, you need to consider that it expands little bit. So the initial radius of this is, or this drop is r. Okay, the thickness by which it has increased, this thickness is, okay, I'll take delta. This is delta r. Delta r is very small, okay? A very small delta r is there, so that when it expands, pressure inside remains fixed. Okay? If I make it expand more than small amount, the pressure inside changes. Okay, I don't want that to happen. Okay, so if let's say inside pressure is P in and outside pressure is PO, inside is P in, outside is PO, I want to use work energy theorem here, that is work done is equal to change in potential energy. Change in kinetic energy is not there, it's a slow process, and anyway the bubble, the drop remains stationary throughout. So work done is change in potential energy. So write down work done in terms of force, potential energy in terms of surface tension S. Surface tension is S. Write down. Try it yourself. It is there in your school curriculum. It's a very, it's a favorite question by school to be asked in your school exam. Done, all of you? Okay, work done will be what? First tell me that. It expands. So which force is doing work? Pressure force is there. All of you appreciate that? Pressure force is there. Pressure force from inside will be like this, and from outside it is like that, perpendicular to the surface. Okay, so the work done is inside pressure into 4 pi r square, that is a total force, into delta R. This work done by the inner pressure, is it positive or negative? Everyone, the work done by inner is positive or negative? All of you type it quickly. Positive. The displacement is in the direction of the force, it is along the radial direction. Okay, work done by the outer pressure, positive or negative? Outer pressure, negative. So minus P naught 4 pi r square delta r. This is equal to change in the potential energy. How do you find change in potential energy in terms of surface tension? Surface tension into change in the surface area, right? How much it is? What is the change in surface area? Do you all appreciate 4 pi r plus delta r whole square minus 4 pi r square increase in the surface area? All of you understand this? Quickly type in whatever I have written here. Work done on the left hand side, change in potential energy on the right hand side. Everybody understood? Two times. Will it be two times? Someone is saying two times. Should I multiply two here? Yes or no? How many interfaces in a drop? In a drop, how many interfaces are there? Only one. Only one interface is there. So you don't need to multiply. Okay, when it is two interface, then the surface area of inner surface increases and as well as outer surface increases, then only. So 4 pi, 4 pi, 4 pi, you cancel out everywhere. Okay, then you can write it as pi minus p naught into r square delta r. This is equal to surface tension, expand it, r square plus delta r square plus 2r delta r minus r square. Okay, now r square get cancelled from here. Can I ignore delta r square compared to 2r delta r? Can I do that? Delta r is very small. If I keep delta r large, inner pressure changes. Right? So delta r square I can ignore. If I ignore that, delta r get cancelled from here. One of the r's will get cancelled. So you will get p inner minus p outer to be equal to 2s by radius. Everybody understood this derivation? Type in quick. Namrata, is it clear? Manchu, Charan, Charan is not there. Doesn't outer surface of drop and air interact? Yes. Yeah, it interacts. That is why surface tension is there. That's why surface tension is there. What do you mean to say? Only one interface. Air and water. That's it. What else? What else? Surface is interface. Surface is interface. Interface between water and air. Like that. In case of bubble, it is air and water, the outer interface, then inner interface, water and air. Yes, in pairs. You take one pair is one interface. Air, water, one interface. Water, air, another interface. Okay, now write down bubble. Here is bubble. I want you to derive the bubble one in exact same way. Exact same way you have to follow and derive the expression for it. Everyone. Inner pressure is Pi, outer pressure is P naught, expansion is delta R, which is very less, surface tension is S. Find out. Use work energy theorem. It is accurate, Shreyas. Don't worry about it. It's accurate. You are ignoring delta r square. Ignorance of delta r square makes it more accurate. Your delta r is very small. If you don't ignore delta r, it means delta r is large. So inner pressure is not same during expansion. Anyone got the answer here in case of bubble? Do you all appreciate that here we have two interfaces, right? So work done is inner pressure 4 pi r square delta R minus outer pressure 4 pi R square delta R. This is equal to change in potential energy. Okay, surface tension is S. So 2 times, because 2 interfaces are there, 2S 4 pi R plus delta R whole square minus 4 pi R square. Okay. So you, when you simplify it, like the way we have done, you can see factor of 2 is there. Everything else is same. So Pi minus P naught will come out to be 4S by radius of the bubble. Now look at this. If, you know, outer pressure is atmospheric pressure most of the time. Outer pressure is atmospheric pressure, which is fixed. Which is fixed. So if you blow air very quickly, Pi will be higher. If air blow is quick. If inner pressure is higher, so Pi minus P naught will be higher. Pi minus P naught will be higher value. Surface tension is fixed, so radius has to be lesser. So that's why small bubbles will come out. Okay, so this is the thing here. Fine. All right. Sometimes we have to treat interface as if it's a part of a bigger drop. What does it mean? Let us discuss that in this scenario. See, I am talking about, but shouldn't pressure decrease when increase in velocity? No. Velocity has become zero. You have blown air, it went inside the bubble, velocity becomes zero. Your kinetic energy converted into pressure energy. That is a different thing. When air is flowing continuously, it is not stopped. Their pressure will be lower. But here, you are confusing between two scenarios. It is not continuously flowing, it is stopped. Okay, kinetic energy got converted into pressure energy. Okay, so what I was talking about here is this scenario. Himanshu understood? Himanshu, what is your doubt? Dekho. Understand this thing. Suppose there is a pipe. Okay. There is a pipe over here. If you blow inside velocity, with certain velocity, there is a curvature like this. So that velocity increases here. Then the pressure will decrease over here. Pressure will decrease because velocity has gone up. Pressure will decrease. But if you have this scenario that you are blowing air from here and you have a stopper here, which doesn't let air to go from here. So air will hit the surface and stop. Getting it? So velocity is not there. Over here, velocity is zero. So entire half rho V square is converted into pressure. Are you getting what I'm trying to say, Himanshu? So similarly, inside the, when you blow air, it goes inside the bubble. When it is leaving your mouth, half rho V square is there. When it goes inside the bubble, air stops. Half rho V square becomes equal to pressure. Velocity becomes zero, right? So these are the two different scenarios, okay? Fine. So what I was talking about, sometimes this is what I wanted to discuss. Sometimes we have to treat the interface as if it is a part of a drafter, as if, okay? For example, sometimes the surface is curved like that. It is curved. It is not flat, okay? So if the interface, if the interface is curved, then pressure just inside liquid is different from pressure just outside. Okay, see what I'm trying to say here. Till now, we have assumed that liquid interface will be flat. So atmospheric pressure here, just inside also atmospheric pressure. So outside and inside, same pressure, just inside, just outside. Over here, pressure just outside and pressure just inside will be different. And you have to treat as if it is a part of a bigger drop, this interface. Are you getting it? As if it is a part of a bigger drop, and if radius of this drop is R, this is of course atmospheric pressure, this is pressure, you can say P1, then PA minus P1 is equal to 2S by radius. So pressure just inside the liquid is slightly lesser than the atmospheric pressure, lesser by 2S by R. Everybody understood this? Everyone understand this, what I have just done? Type in quickly, whatever doubts you have. Is it clear? Type it. This is the most important thing. If a question comes, most probably on it will come on capillary rise, which is based on this. Type it, everyone, I'm waiting. Okay, I'll repeat it again. Everyone, I'll repeat it again. First of all, tell me one thing. If the surface is flat, radius is what? Radius of this surface is? If the surface is flat, radius tends to infinity. Put R as infinity over here. Inner pressure and outer pressure become equal. Okay, fine. So now let me explain whatever I had explained just now is this. If the interface is not flat, if it is curved, we need to assume the interface as if it is a part of a bigger drop. Then only we can use this formula to find out pressure inside the liquid. Why I have to find pressure inside the liquid? Because when I use this, P2 is equal to P1 plus rho GH, both the points should be inside the liquid. But when surface is curved, pressure inside and pressure outside are not equal. So we can't say P1 is atmospheric pressure if surface is curved. So I have to use this formula. In order to use this formula, which I have derived only for the drop, I have to consider as if the interface is a part of a bigger drop. Everyone understood that now? Everyone clear? Who was asking it? Those who were asking it to explain again, is it clear? Okay. See, it'll be more clear when we take the numericals, of course. Class 10th physics and 11th physics, hell lot of difference. You might have experienced it by now. So only way is to solve numericals to understand. So we are going to solve a numerical on capillary rise. What is it? How does capillary look like? Have you seen it? Have you seen capillary? No one? What is the difference between capillary and a test tube? Capillary and a test tube, what is the difference? Capillary is very thin, okay? What is the basic difference? Basic. Of course it is thin, but there is one fundamental difference. What it is? Capillary is open on both sides. Okay, capillary is open on both sides. Test tube open on one side, closed on the other side. That is, that you should take care. Okay, so we are going to learn about the capillary rise. So all of you draw the diagram with me. This is probably the most important derivation of entire chapter. Okay, and most probably this will come in your school exam. So we have a capillary over here. I am drawing capillary little thicker than usual so that the drawing is better. But otherwise, capillary, as you said, yes, it is very thin. So the level of water, I'm taking blue color here. If you give a large surface, because of the gravity, the surface automatically becomes flat. But in a capillary, it can create a curvature because the surface area is lesser. So you can assume these are the flat surfaces. Okay. But when you put a capillary, a rise in the level of water is seen inside the capillary and a curve at the top is seen like that. Like this. Okay. Now there is something called the angle of contact. Angle of contact is the angle between the tangent at the point of contact and the capillary. This is angle of contact. Okay. This one is angle of contact theta. Fine. This height is h. This is the capillary rise. Ideally, there should not be any capillary rise. Do you all understand? Because it is open to the atmosphere, ideally, the water should not rise up. But it is seen that it rises up. Outside pressure is atmospheric pressure. Okay. If the density of the water is rho, surface tension is s, I want you to find out what is h. Okay, in terms of everything else, what is h? Try this. हाँ सॉरी, द रेडियस, रेडियस ऑफ द कैपिलरी इज गिवन, सॉरी, द रेडियस ऑफ द कैपिलरी इज गिवन विच इज स्मॉल ए. ओके, दिस इज स्मॉल ए. गुड दैट यू आस्ट. स्मॉल ए इज अ रेडियस ऑफ द कैपिलरी. यू हैव टू राइट. हाँ, नाउ यू कैन डू इट. What is the first thing you have to find? What is the first thing you have to find? Type in. Radius of the bubble. All of you agree that I have to find radius of the bubble first. Is it a bubble or a drop? Part of a bubble or a drop? It's a drop, right? So, do you all agree that if I drop a perpendicular to the angle of contact like this and put a line like this symmetrical to it, they will intersect at the center? Everybody understand this? This will be the center. Okay, we have to find this R. Now, can you tell me what is R? Find out what is R. What's R? In terms of A and theta, what is R? Okay, Aditya got it. Others? It's always good to find out the right angle triangles. Drop like this. Correct. Those who got it, correct. This angle will be what? This angle is what? All of you, is this theta? That is theta, right? So theta is given, hypotenuse is R, base is A. This is A. Okay. So A by R is equal to cos theta. So R is equal to A sec theta, right? If angle of contact is given, the radius of the imaginary drop is A sec theta. Okay. Now, which side pressure is higher? This side or that side? Pressure inside the drop is more or outside? Inside it is more, but here there is no inside outside. Right? Because it is not a complete this thing. So basically, you should know that the pressure is always higher on concave side. Concave side. So please remember this. Concave side pressure is higher. How to identify concave? Concave looks like a cave. Okay, it will be like this, like entrance of a cave. All right. Anyways, so PA is more than pressure just inside. Let's say pressure just inside is P1. So PA minus P1 is equal to 2S by radius, which is A C theta. Right. So P1 is equal to PA minus 2S cos theta by A. Right. Now what to do next? After this, what should I do? What is the pressure over here? At this level, what is the pressure? At this level, what should be the pressure? Should it be atmospheric pressure? Over here, pressure is atmospheric pressure, right? So I can say P1, which is PA minus 2s by A cos theta plus rho gh. This is equal to what? PA. Everybody understood till now? Everybody understood? So H is 2s by a rho g cos theta. This is the capillary rise. It happens because of surface tension. If surface tension is zero, capillary rise is zero. Understood? If the curved surface is hemisphere, hemisphere, then what is theta? If it is hemisphere at the top, theta will be what? What is theta? Theta will be 0 degrees. Angle of contact is zero. The capillary itself becomes tangent. Fine. Last step is what? This is P1. P1 is pressure just inside. Over here, this red dot you see here, pressure inside I got on this point. This is P1. P1 plus rho gh is pressure over here. Which you use, right? You use P1 plus rho gh is equal to P2. Point number one and two both should be inside the liquid. You should not take a point outside. Okay, but till now, pressure outside, which is atmospheric pressure, is equal to the pressure just inside the liquid. That is why we used to casually write PA plus rho gh. Because PA is just outside and just inside. But now since there's a curvature, pressure just inside and pressure just outside, they are not equal. Understood? Okay, now tell me, one thing. I have just two things left. One is this, other one is a numerical. Then we are done for today. Okay. Let's say you put a capillary over here. This is a capillary. It need not be that upper surface be like this. Upper surface can be like that also. Do you understand? Look at the previous thing. The upper surface is like this, the upward opening curve. What if it is downward opening curve? Okay. What if it is downward opening curve? Then which diagram is correct? This is the liquid. It is capillary open from both sides. This one, that one, where the interface will be 1, 2, 3. Of course, it won't be 2. Unnecessary, I made 2. Tell me, 1 or 3. Acha, let's assume it is 3 right now. Let's assume it is 3. Tell me, pressure inside will be more or pressure outside will be more if it is 3? Where pressure will be more, inside or outside? Inside will be more. So inside pressure is more than atmospheric pressure already. Over here, P1 is more than atmospheric pressure. So now that more than atmospheric pressure plus rho gh, will it be equal to atmospheric pressure? Do you get what I'm trying to say? P1 plus rho gh is atmospheric pressure, right? Look at this. P1 plus rho gh is atmospheric pressure. Your P1 is already more than atmospheric pressure. Right? You get a negative H. What does it mean? It means it is below. the level. Okay, so if the curvature is downward opening, then this is the correct one. Okay, it will go down below. This is H. If the curvature is like that, fine. So pressure over here is atmospheric pressure, and pressure over there is atmospheric pressure plus rho gh. This is P1. Okay, so this is P1 minus PA is equal to 2s by radius of curvature. Radius of curvature can be written as A sec theta, where theta is a contact angle. So you understand, right? It all depends on, see, the thing is that what I'm trying to convey here, do not memorize the final results. Do not memorize the derivations. Derivation you use to understand, because I can tweak the scenario a little bit. Like, for example, this one, you have learned capillary rise. So you think that every time capillary will rise up. It need not. Okay, it depends on the interface is upward opening or downward opening. So keep your mind open about it, and you should learn how things are derived. Then only you'll be able to solve those tricky kind of numericals. Okay, so the last thing for today is a numerical from your textbook only. So let me quickly take it. It will take around 10 minutes. And do it your own, okay? It's very easy to copy things, and you know, that's all useless. At the end, don't give surprises to your parents, to yourself. Be very, very honest to yourself, whatever you do. Nobody will lose. Do this, everyone. First, you get the value in terms of expressions, like diameter is D, height, depth, it is dipped at a height of H, surface tension is S, atmospheric pressure is PA, density is rho and G. In terms of these, you get first. Do in terms of these and then put the values. Okay, don't understand, right? Get the expression of the answer. Madhav, with which exam you are writing? Sunday. You don't want Sunday? Anyone close to the answer? Anyone? See, entire tube is filled with air. So you consider entire tube to be having the same pressure. Don't assume that with height, pressure changes inside the tube, okay? Because air is there, you can ignore the density is very less. So ignore the variation of the pressure with the height. I'm assuming all of you are drawing the diagram. Okay. Anyone close to the answer? No one? Okay. Anyways, all of you focus here. When you blow air from here, it should create a hemispherical shape over there. This is what the scenario is. Okay. So let's say the height over here, final answer, I'm not interested, expression. This is H, fine. This is H, atmospheric pressure is PA. So pressure just outside it, let's say P1 is PA plus rho GH. This is P1 and I want to find out P2. Tell me which pressure is higher, P1 or P2? Everyone. P2 because it is on the concave side, right? So P2 minus PA minus rho GH, P2 minus P1 is equal to 2S by R. R is what? Diameter divided by 2, right? Diameter is given. So because it is hemisphere, the radius of the capillary is equal to the radius of the hemisphere also. So there's 4S by D. So P2 is atmospheric pressure plus rho GH plus 4S by D. Type in quickly, all of you understood this? Everyone? Okay. All right, so you know, we have 2-3 minutes. The last part of the chapter, theoretical one, no numerical, nothing. So I'm talking about surface tension in day-to-day life, because I have seen in your school exam, they ask these things. Surface tension. In day-to-day life. Okay. So have you seen when you throw water drops on the banana leaves, it dances around in a spherical, as if it is a spherical droplets are dancing around. Have you seen it? And when you put water on a cotton surface, the cotton will absorb it, right? Cotton will absorb it. So it seems as if sometimes water doesn't spread on a surface and sometimes water spreads on the surface, okay? And that happens because of the surface tension, okay? So basically, if water spreads, it increases its surface area. Okay, no, we are not talking about a phase change. Water, when it becomes vapor, the complete properties changes. So change of state should not happen. Okay, fine. So when water, let's say, spread on the surface, the interface between water, let's say, if water spreads on the banana leaf, so there is a surface tension between banana leaf and water. Okay, if surface tension between banana leaf and water is very large compared to surface tension between water and air, then it will not form an interface between banana and water, because energy will increase if it spreads. Surface tension is higher between water and banana, so why it should spread? Getting it? So same logic holds when you put antiseptic on your skin. It spreads evenly, very nicely. It spreads antiseptic or any moisturizer cream or anything like that spreads very nicely, because surface tension between cream and your skin is very less compared to surface tension between cream and air. So when the cream spreads on the skin, it decreases its energy, which is favorable. Fine. So that is the reason why it spreads. Fine. And same logic holds good. For example, when you have to wash the clothes, if you don't put the detergent, just use the water, then the surface tension between dust and water is very high. So it doesn't come out. It doesn't mix with water. Otherwise, interface between water and dust will increase. So energy has increased because surface tension is higher. So you put detergent. So one part of the detergent, its surface tension between one part of detergent and the dust is very less. So dust will get mixed with one part of the detergent. Another part of the detergent, its surface tension with water is very less. So one part of the detergent mixes with the water, other part mixes with the dust, because their respective surface tensions are very less. So when it mixes up, it decreases its energy. And that's why you use detergent. So, these are the few examples of day-to-day life examples of surface tension. Fine. So we are done, guys, with this chapter. Fluids is over. So I hope you appreciate that today's topic, what we have done, is as important as entire fluid statics or entire fluid dynamics, where fluid is flowing. So that is the reason why I have taken exact same amount of time teaching these things when you compare it with I teaching fluid statics or fluid flowing, so that you don't take it lightly. Fine. So I guess that's it from my side.